what can we get the most yield from? Usually that's ads. So we start with ads, and we start with ads in a whatever job board or vertical that may not be super writing related, but it is catering to like whatever finance professionals or economics people or project managers. So we'll try to start there.
Welcome to the Jolly and Sorcery Knowledge Series, made for smart business leaders who want to stay ahead of the competition using proven strategies. Each session, Jolly and Sorcery chat with an authority in a specific digital niche. From SEO to PR and beyond, these leaders reveal the tactics and mindsets that changed their game and could change yours. Without further ado, here's your host, Greg Hylers.
Should be good. Okay. Hey, Brad, thank you so much for coming on here. We crossed paths, I believe it was in TTT. We crossed paths because USERP is doing similar yet different to what Jolly does, except you guys have been doing it for years longer, right? And you have your hand in a lot of other stuff, your guiding hand, right? Not just like dipped in, like you're full force in a lot of stuff. So I'm really excited for you to come on today because we have been working with writers for over 5 years. I came up as a writer, and you have a lot of experience with writers. So I'm pretty confident I'm going to learn something from you today. And I'd also love just to kind of talk shop as we go, kind of writer management, not 101, hopefully like more like 301 at some points. So for if sure. You don't mind, if you could introduce yourself a little, what you're working on, that'd be awesome.
Yeah, definitely. Of course. Thanks for having me. I'm excited to like talk about all this super nerdy stuff.
Yes.
That would put most people to sleep. But so my name is Brad Smith. I run, my main business is Codeless. I think it's been around now for like 7-ish years, something like that.
I applied to you guys, but you never responded to me.
Oh, I'm sorry. We do get, we'll get into this, but we get a lot of writers and we're usually looking for something, and that's, it's good for us. It's bad for writers because we make them jump through hoops and a lot of other things. And we're usually looking for something very specific. So it's not just like the, it's a very specific style of writer we're looking for. So I can get into more, but
it's like,
yeah, Codeless. What's that? Sorry.
No, I'm going to keep interrupting you all day.
Oh, that's all right. So Codeless has been around for, like I said, 7 years. I think I've been self-employed for like 10, something like that. We started USERP maybe a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, something like that. And that's been going really well. It's been growing really fast. Basically, I learned all my mistakes trying to get Codeless off the ground. And so, you know, in 2 years, USERP has done what we were able to do under Codeless in like 5 or 6, basically, because I had no idea what I was doing and I made all the mistakes. And then last year we acquired Wordable and just rebuilt it, and we're getting ready to relaunch it soon. So that's exciting, but also, as you can imagine, like a lot of work and a lot of time and all the fun things. So yeah, I'm doing a few things. Most of my stuff, all of our stuff's really, really tightly related. So they all kind of work together. Like we acquired Wordable because we were a customer and because we were actually like, we do all this stuff manually already. USERP is a natural extension. If we're creating the content for people, then we need to help them distribute that content and promote it. Otherwise it doesn't perform properly or correctly. And then it like devalues the content work. So all these things are like really tightly aligned. And I think that's how it helps, slightly to manage everything.
Yeah. This is fascinating to me because I always tell people we used to be a mid-tier content agency. That's how I put it at Jolly. We didn't have the strategy, we had the execution, but we didn't have what USERP does, the promotion, which is key.
Yeah.
And Well, forever we're going to remain in that mid-tier, because if you don't promote your content, at least at that day and age, how was it ever going to get noticed unless that site already had organic traffic?
For sure.
So that makes a ton of sense. I really want to focus on how you guys, but then your advice for other people scaling content teams, right? We've vetted 1,000 or so writers. You, I think, have done multiples of that. So I'm curious, for starters, like what's your go-to source or sources, if you don't mind sharing them? And have they been exhausted, some of them, and do you come back to them, or
Yeah, we go back to them a lot. So I'll give you like a little bit of context, because I think where people get hung up is like we probably don't do anything that different or special compared to what most people do. We just do it like at an OCD level and like 10x of what everyone else is doing probably. And so the reason I say that is like we have the same bottleneck. Finding good writers is always hard. And I can get into more detail on like, again, the type of writers, what we look for. But the easiest solution to find more good writers is just to look at way more writers. And so people make the same mistake when they hire like for an internal role. They're like, we need to hire a marketing person. So we're going to drop a note in Slack, you know, like in a Slack group. And then we're going to get like 5 responses. And I'm going to like try to pick 1 of 5. Like that doesn't work. What if you're really going to like airproof this thing and you're really going to like hire a lot of good writers, you need to look at like thousands and hire like 1% basically. So I think that's like the key is, you know, we use all the usual suspects. So we use Pro Blogger job board. We use like all the writing job boards. We also work with a lot of subject matter experts, especially for like bigger enterprise clients. And so in those cases, we have to find like an actual economist who can write on. And so those types of people, you're not always going to find through those like writing, you know, job boards. Writing job boards are good for like a good cross section of like pretty good writers on general topics. So we also go into like verticals where even take finance, for instance, like what are all the sub verticals of finance? You have like equities, you have debt, you have economics, you have accounting, you have corporate finance. So even drilling down into those where it's like, okay, our finance team is all right. We're good in like personal finance. We're good in investments, but we're light on accounting, corporate finance. So we really need now to drill down into those areas. So I don't think what we do, and I'm happy to go into more sources and stuff, but we use probably the same sources that most people do. We test them a lot too. So we say, you know, we spent this, here's the average quality. Here's the number of people we got back. Did it look good? Yes or no. Next month when we do it again, how do we shift budget around a little bit? Yeah. So I think our key, or, you know, what we've been able to do well is just scale the recruiting process and then set up internal processes in a good way so that we just will constantly look and vet new people. And so we've probably had, I don't know, like 5,000 plus people.
I was one.
Submit. Yeah,
exactly. I'm a row there somewhere.
I'm gonna go look for it now.
Yeah,
I'm gonna go look for it.
Well, if I can, interrupt. Something you said is very interesting to me because we just started doing that at Jolly. I think what you're doing when you're looking for these specialists, the kind you're not necessarily gonna find on ProBlogger, maybe they'll stumble across it. Are you doing one-to-one outreach then? Are you having a team member sift through these potential places people within these vertical would it be?
We have. It sucks, to be honest. It's like, it's super time consuming. So we do that. It's again, usually we try to stick to what can we get the most yield from? Usually that's ads. So we start with ads, and we start with ads in a whatever job board or vertical that may not be super writing related, but it is catering to like whatever finance professionals or economics people or project managers. So we'll try to start there. Where we will do more one-to-one outreach type of stuff is when we're looking for very specific people. So like this finance example I gave you, if we are really light in corporate finance and we're struggling to find a really good corporate finance person or people, because again, you don't probably need one. You need like 2 or 3 and test them, and then you pick one from those. That's when we'll start to get a little more like personalized, but we really try to set it up to scale. Otherwise, all the things we use down the recruiting funnel become really challenging if we just don't have enough numbers. And so that's where it's, the other problem here, or the other pain point we can talk about, is if we're doing one-to-one outreach, usually people do is like that means someone who's more senior has to actually review all these people, and that also screws up your process. And so that's another reason why we do it in a different way, and we try to do more of a scalable approach, is because we want to limit the amount of time our senior people are actually looking at published samples, that sort of thing. So I haven't been involved in our recruiting process for years now, our main editor is the one who's reviewing published samples, but like every other piece of the process needs to be done by someone, you know, lower on the totem pole. Because that main editor has like more important things to do. I have more important things to do. So the mechanisms or whatever you use to actually find and vet people usually also have like an internal resource cost, and that has a huge bearing on things too.
So that's how I wanted to say, I mean, people listening might hear you say ads for writers. Like, why would you spend money on that? At least for me, it was a question that came up. What helped me is thinking about it in terms of CAC, right? Like, we all are willing to spend money to get clients. You're going to spend money on these, on HR. You're going to spend money on your team members' time. It's more efficient to spend money on an ad, develop a system where you can quickly and, quite frankly, ruthlessly cut out all the people who are never going to have a chance to deliver what you needed, and only use your core team members' time for writers who have a shot at being part of your team. It makes a ton of sense to me.
Yeah, because I mean, if you think about like the pro blogger job board ad off the top of my head, it's like what, 150 for like a feature?
Something
listing.
Like that, yeah.
That is so cheap. Like that's like 3 hours of one of our senior people's time.
And then you'll get whatever, 75, 150. Exactly. A lot of them will be garbage. There will be a gym or two. You spend 2 to 3 hours of your team members' time in budget to get that good writer. If you've had them review and do custom outreach to dozens of what appear to be good writers, my goodness, that would be, I don't know, a couple days.
For sure. The other thing, it gives us a bunch of benefits too outside of that, because number one, it's on demand. So I can do it whenever I want. I can throw up an ad today and tomorrow I'm going to have 100 new people to look at.
Yeah.
So I can do it like very, in an agency environment, you need to move fast, right? You don't have the, we don't have the luxury that like a SaaS company does, in that we can just like slowly take our time and like vet everyone. And we're like, no, we need to like churn and burn. Like we need to move, because that's, you know, our clients are expecting us to like hit deadlines and we can't be delayed. We also look for a couple things. We try to build an internal buffer. So if our capacity, we do like 300 articles plus a month right now. Our internal capacity, writing capacity, is actually more than that. So we could probably handle 350 to 400.
Excellent.
So we build in this buffer, and then the buffer is what we're managing internally. So if we see that buffer start to shrink because we're taking on new clients, or our existing clients are ramping up, that's when we trigger to, we need more people to find. And then by running ads and stuff, we can kind of laser target it a little more and then keep running databases of all these people. So even if a writer isn't a good fit for this one client we had in mind today, I just had a sales call like, you know, 2 days ago. They were like, we're looking for this style of finance writer. I said, no problem. I go into our database. I type in like some of the sites we're looking for. And then boom, I pull up 5-10 different published samples that would be a better fit for this other client. And then I'm able to go back to those writers now and follow up with them. So amazing. It's an asset. It becomes an asset, a database of, you know, 5,000 plus writers that we're constantly recruiting from and we're constantly adding to. It's not like my senior manager has a Google Doc somewhere that no one can remember what it's called. And so we can't find those 10 people that she was following up with, and she left or she got sick. And so now I can't get access to those people. Like it's people in the marketing space, I think, need to work, I was this way too, need to get better at like operations and processes, and start thinking of things in this fashion, because that's usually what holds them back on the execution. It's not a lack of ideas. It's not, you know, there's too many ideas. That's the problem. It's more about like just figuring out the system that works for you and where you're not willing to kind of bend, you know?
Well, we'll call this a masterclass for Greg at least, but managing the buffer, I feel like that soundbite needs to get preserved, because that's a really cool concept. I prepared questions for us connecting today, and I talked about, you know, we experienced the pain points of bottlenecks, you know, finding good writers. And that's, you flipped that to your bottleneck is when the buffer starts getting close. It's not even a bottleneck, you know, like you're definitely proactively preventing that bottleneck, which I admire, because we have struggled with that pain point and yet never thought to look at it that way. We're obviously, hey, we should get more writers. We should get ahead on writers. but not that far where we're like, let's define how far ahead we want to be.
Yep. Yeah. So usually the problems with finding good writers, again, is that they're hard. We need certain types of writers. And so we do a lot of high volume stuff. We want to test everyone and then hire them like part-time, full-time when we find the best people. That's a process, you know what I mean? That takes like weeks and months and there's training involved. That being said, we're not like a SaaS company. I don't have like, it's all bootstrap. I don't have like, you know, a Series A sitting in my bank account and yeah. That lets me like hire someone full-time and then train them and then try them out. Like I can't, like, we don't have the time for that. We don't have the, you know, resources for that. And so we will, usually when people need to hire a good writer, it's already too late.
Yeah.
So what that really means is you should have been looking for writers a month ago and you should have already vetted a few and trained them up, because usually what happens is you ultimately hire 1%. So you look at 100 writers or whatever the numbers are. You look at 100 writers, 10 of those are going to be decent, like a decent fit for what you're looking for right now. And what we're looking for is a combination of subject matter expertise, topics, published samples and writing ability, cost, turnaround. So if someone tells me they can only write one a week right now, I say, that's fine. It might be a little on the light side for us because we need someone who can write a little more. Maybe they have other clients and stuff. That's not a big deal. So it's just like, but we factor all that stuff in. What's your average turnaround for an article? If a freelancer or contractor or employee's average turnaround for an article is like a week or two, like that's probably not going to work for us. Cause again, we're trying to manage like a lot of workload. So we need to go deeper with writers. We can't just like give, you know, five people one article each. So we kind of factor all these things in. And then you test 10, you literally test 10 people. So we pay 10 people to write stuff for us. Five are going to be garbage. And they're going to get trashed. Like we can't use them for client projects. We've tried that too, where it's like, oh, maybe we'll take like a future client article and have them like test on that. Doesn't work because they're going to be like, the majority are going to suck.
This goes back into recruiting budget, right? Like you're spending money to save pain down the road. You want to pay these writers, let them do their best for you and realize their best isn't even good enough to start training. So we can't work together. And definitely not good enough to show a client, to your point. Yeah. You know, we used to do that too. We used to be super efficient, even at our little done-for-you service. We're like, let's pick some opportunities with the deadline 2 days from now, and we'll get these. It's like, my goodness, that was insane. Yeah. I mean, that thankfully is more than a year in the past, and by the time this comes out, more so. But I'm glad you learned that lesson. It took us a while to learn that lesson.
Yes. And then your client's like, how come these things are delayed? And it's like, oh, because we had to rewrite it five times, the same article. You know what I mean? So we have like very specific guidelines on like, this is exactly what we want to see from you people. Again, you test 10, you hire like three of those people. And I mean, the hire is like you train them, you slowly ramp them up. So maybe in a month or two, they're ready to write for clients. And that's ultimately like how you look. So I think, again, it goes back to like, starting, you know, a month or two before you think you need to start, look at like 10 times the number of people you think you need to look at, and then really kind of like aggressively ramp them up and test them to actually, you know, see if they're going to be a good fit long term.
I'm curious about what you just said. You said maybe in a month or two they're ready to write for clients. Are you providing them, obviously not full time, but you're providing them with multiple test projects then, not just the initial paid?
Yeah, so the initial test, you know, article project is just that. It's like a one-off. From there, we usually put them through like a training program. And then it's almost like a probation period, I guess, if you want to think of it that way. So we'll maybe schedule them like for one a week to start. And we'll say, okay, once a week.
A lighter load.
Yeah, exactly. And then we're going to have our editors like oversee it and really work with you. But in the background, our editors are like literally grading these people and rating them and saying like, you know, here's where they're good, here's where they struggle. That is usually what determines after about a month or two. They usually tell us like, hey, you know, cut these people for these reasons. Reassign these people to different topics because they struggle with something that's a little more technical or whatever. Or these people are great, ramp them up, like give them more money. So we also, we spend a lot of more money on like the ads and recruiting, but we also control our costs more on the actual writing. So we know what writing levels are worth it to us from a cost perspective. So we ask for writers rates, but we also internally know like what's going to work for us and what's not going to work for us. And then so subject matter experts cost this, medium level writers cost this, entry level writers cost this. We can help people move. So if they want to like make more, we can help them do that and get them to write better. But we know what that is. And then we know conversely what our editing costs are on top of that. So if we hire a cheap writer, but my editor spends an hour or two on their piece rewriting it, like that's not going to work. So doing the hard part of like figuring that stuff out is usually what prevents people from scaling all these things, because they don't know how much things cost. They don't like have all these, variables factored in.
What about, I think we tend to think about from the agency owner perspective. Have you, as a thought exercise, or maybe at Wordable, it's appropriate from a smaller business? I don't even know the size of Wordable. Didn't mean to offend if it's already.
No, it's small.
Yeah. It's small. Well, you mentioned bootstrapped. We're bootstrapping our own tasks. Like we feel all that. So for the bootstrappers out there, for the business of ones, any of this advice change a little, do you think, in terms of, we talked about really good solutions for scale. Some of these I think could be boiled down and reduced and still work, but anything you think actually you'd need to do the 180 of this, or at least like a pivot?
Yeah, I think it depends. And I'll clarify. So my background, I used to be like a freelance writer. I used to like be the person of one doing all this stuff. It depends on what that person's trying to do, what they're good at, and then what their goals are. So for instance, some founders and some business owners of one might think that they're going to save money by writing.
Yeah,
but they're probably not, because they're not going to stick.
Unless you're an amazing copywriter.
Exactly. They're probably not a good writer. They're probably not going to stick to it. It's probably a better use of their time to like do the money making stuff. And then just like, so that's where the caveat is. It's like, is this person actually going to be doing the work or not? And the reason I say that is because if they are, then that's great. And there's ways to make your process more efficient. So for example, if I send like a really long email to a client, I'm going to copy and paste some of that email stuff, or I'm going to use it in a pitch. I'm going to copy and paste a lot of that stuff and use it for my next article. Mm-hmm. So what can I reuse that I'm already kind of like talking about with people in the actual content to make it easier if I'm personally, writing it? Otherwise, if you're a person of one and you're trying to get someone to do content for you, I would still say don't hire, it's like salespeople. Don't hire one salesperson, hire like three or four, have them write for a month or two, and then pick the best one and have them do all your content. And make sure that you give them some actual guidelines to work from. So this is the other thing that drives me nuts about like owners and founders are like, we have like this weird DNA and we are controlling and we're crazy and we think we do everything the best and we like wanna just have our hands on everything. The problem is when you're scaling something like content that's subjective, is you're too hands-on and you're too micromanaging. So you need to have very good guidelines of like, here's how we talk about things. Here's what I want to see. Here's what my view on this topic is. And so it's, especially if you're going to have these people ghostwrite for you, this becomes even more difficult because how do I know what's in your head? You know what I mean? And if I'm a writer and I'm writing for someone, maybe I don't even agree with what this person is telling me. You know what I mean? So it just becomes really difficult to scale that. And this is why, like, especially when I always laugh when I hear like founders or owners say like, oh yeah, I've tried like all these writers and I can never find a good writer. It's like, well, it's probably because your process sucks, like it's probably because like you didn't actually help outside people understand what the hell you want.
And no, then, like, no, it's not me. It's
exactly. It never is. Yeah, it never is. And ghostwriting is like, I would just say, don't ghostwrite them. Just have this writer, having them try to understand you and talk like you. And it's incredibly difficult. And we do it because we have really expensive writers and we've been doing this a long time. And it's very, very difficult. And so just don't have people ghostwrite for you, just because it's going to make this problem a lot harder than it needs to be.
We have several clients like those at Jolly. And quite frankly, a lot of them unfortunately end up being temporary clients. They signed on with the idea, and once they began experiencing it, I think it was something they could just not jive with. The ghostwriting couldn't. And that's, I agree with you. If you're never going to be okay with ghostwriting, you need to get a writer then who you're comfortable with sharing some credit of the business with, and let them put it on them. Obviously you want them to be part of your brand, but let them put it on themselves if you don't want them to speak for you.
What
ghostwriter or not, and I guess we don't need to make it like a bloopers reel, but like, what are some of the like early warning red flags that someone maybe who's new to mid at range experience at recruiting writers, so they can start to preview some of these things? We have multiple writer managers, let's call them for a generic term, at Jolly. And I'm working with at least one of them to coach them on being more comfortable with acknowledging the red flags. For example, a writer who starts on Monday, maybe has put in a half an hour by Friday of the gig they said they wanted. Well, as a former freelancer, I know what's happened. They got other gigs going on, and that's fine. They're stacking all the work they can. This just one example I'm trying to coach my manager of. Tell the writer when they start, they better be ready to do the gig they signed up for, because that's what we need. So I'm curious, you know, there's tons of other examples. What are some you've learned and systematized as kind of non-negotiables? Like, look, it's coming up. We're going to have to cut ties.
For sure. I'll try to rattle off like a few, but when we look at writers in the very beginning, if someone's rate is too low, that's a warning sign.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're probably not going to be, there's a correlation between writer rates and quality and professionalism. It's not always exact, and there's varying degrees, but they're overall, the better the writer, the more professional the writer, the more expensive they cost. So there's ranges. So that's usually a red flag.
Wait, as an agency owner, you're not always trying to scrape maximum profit off of every single interaction in your life?
I'm not, and I should be maybe. But the problem is you hamstring, people view marketing as an investment or an expense, like the general public. I'm on the investment side. That's why we try to work with big companies, and we charge a lot of money for content. Like, people are always like, how much do you charge for content? And like, why do you charge that? And why do people pay that? It's like, well, cause I need to pay good writers, and I can't do that. I can't afford good writers if I don't charge a lot of money on top of it. So,
well, that's how you get to your level where you don't look as content as an aesthetic thing on a website.
Yeah.
It's part of the funnel. There's an ROI that your clients expect.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what we tell clients all the time. That's what we tell like prospects, is like, look, we charge this because I care about the results that we're trying to get you. And I don't want to make, if you make me price it at this, I'm going to have to cut corners. I'm going to have to remove editing. I'm going to have to use shitty writers.
Yeah.
So I'm going to have to start removing a lot of things that's ultimately just going to sabotage your own results. And I'm not willing to do that. So like, go use one of those cheaper writing services. You know what I mean? Like, have fun trying to edit and wrangle and plan and all the things that come involved. But so that's an issue, for sure. Deadlines and turnarounds. So we look for two things. We say, what's your average turnaround per article? And they tell us like, whatever, 3 days. So we say, okay, here's a test article. Here's your deadline in 3 days. And we're not like trying to be assholes. We're just trying to like figure out what the expectations are, and then like see if people can actually hit that. And if they can't, if their test project's late and there's not a good reason, then that's usually an issue. Like, that's usually a red flag. With managing writers, we manage writers on a per article basis, not per hour. So I know a 2,000 word article of a certain quality should take a certain amount of time. In our field, 2,000 word article in our space should roughly take 4 to 8 hours, based on the requirement, like subject matter expertise, requirements, you know,
time if they align, like, you know,
exactly all the things. Yeah. So then I know how much, if this writer tells me they can do X amount of articles per week, then we know how much time that should be taking them. And therefore we know what the appropriate payment should be. And then we have them bill us at the end of the month for the work completed in that, and the work completed that was accepted during that time window. So that's the other thing, is like, if the client doesn't accept the article, or we don't accept the article, then you need to keep working on it If there's a reason, then we'll pay you. So if a client comes back, changes scope, we'll pay writers more to change something that they shouldn't have had to change. Like, we're not that unfair, but we're also not like, we're also not like new at this, where we're just going to like, you know, let people say one thing and do another. And so we're very much like, let people's actions speak for themselves. And again, hold them to tight deadlines, see how they react, pay them what they want to. So like we'll pay. So someone tells me they charge $450 an hour. Okay. Or $450 an article. Okay, cool. We'll pay you $450 an article. Like, you better deliver that shit on time. It better be good. Yeah. You know what I mean? And then we're happy to keep paying you. But if not, then we're going to cut you like as soon as possible, because in an agency environment, if we tell a big client that we have these deadlines and we're going to deliver a certain quality to them, like, that's what we're optimizing for, is like this middle ground of keeping the writing team happy and busy and fulfilled career-wise, because they're working for good clients and people that know what they're doing, and they're not having to like chase payment and do all the other, you know, things that suck from freelancing. But those are usually some of the biggest red flags, for sure.
If a listener could get that as the takeaway, you know, the phrase, it goes both ways. It's true in all the different aspects of what you just described. If the business owner is willing to treat the writer as an, call it an asset, call it a peer, call it a, you know, a team member, that's all they want. They want to be paid for their work and treated like a valuable team member. And anytime you mention cut corners, anytime you try to cut corners in that relationship, that's when it all goes south. The result will be impacted, and makes a ton of sense to me. That's, you know, we don't have employees. We have 1099 or W-8-BEN, but we treat them as if it's the kind of gig I would want to do when I was a freelancer. And that's why it works, by and large. Every business has its kinks. That makes a ton of sense to me, man. What did I forget to ask, or didn't think to ask? Not forget. Let's not give me too much credit. Like, there's a lot you've learned that I haven't, because you have a couple years on me in the business, but also the scale is a little larger. And also, I like how, as you mentioned, your different services and businesses are complementary. So you're seeing this from a couple different angles within our space. What did I miss?
I think one of the keys is scaling anything is no different than like delegating and hiring for a different role. And what the most mistakes people make in writing is they try to scale or try to find more writers, but they don't actually know what they want exactly. And it's going to be a moving target then. Like, you or your team are going to come up with all these soft, fuzzy intangibles, like, oh, well, this person sounded better than this person. And like, this person's emails and Slack messages were funnier, I don't know, than these person's. Like, you don't actually know what you want, meaning this is the strategy. This is the content type we need. This is the style of writer we need based on this content. So I want my introductions to look like this. I want my subheads to be written like this. I want my images to be cited like this. I want my conclusions to be written like this. And until you like nail that down, throwing 100 writers at that is going to be a nightmare. You know what I mean? It's going to be chaos, because you're not giving, going back to like treating people fairly, you're not giving, if you're setting the writers up to fail, that's your fault. It's not the writer's fault. So some of these things I'm talking about may make us sound like, you know, assholes, and that's not the intent. The intent is like to be super, super clear on expectations and communication, because we're a remote company. That's another thing. We hire people all over the world. I can't talk to someone on a different side of the world. I personally don't want to, I can't talk to all the people that are writing for us like all the time. So there's no one overseeing you, you know? And that means the expectations need to be super clear. And that means the style of content or what they're going to be writing about, even down to like how we want things written in certain places on the page, until you nail those things down, you'll never ever scale content beyond, you know, an article or two a week. Because you luck in to finding the one unicorn writer supposedly that is good, that just gets you. You know what I mean? Like, intuitively, you just know this is what companies always say. And then they're like, oh, well, that person got sick or whatever, is on maternity leave or got a better paying job somewhere probably or whatever. and we're not able to find any other writers who just get us. And it's like, well, that's not the problem. The problem is you haven't taken the time to actually define what you want. And that's why you can't find it. It's not the writer's fault, it's your fault. So I think that's the other big thing here to really understand is like the hard part is execution. The hard part is like the doing. The way you make that easier is by having much better, clearer kind of operations and processes and systems. And it's not on finding special people. It's not on some like special job board that no one knows about. You know what I mean? It's like, it's where everyone's using the same tools and everything else. It's just how you're doing it that's different.
I mean, the term I latched onto in 2020 was productized, which I was like repulsed by prior to that. I thought writing was so special, so creative. You know, I as a freelancer certainly was special, but but again, as you said, we're not trying to be assholes. We're trying to set people up for success here. That's the goal, yeah. All of us. And when you define deliverables clearly, and not just the deliverable, but the process to arrive at that for people new to your system, this is for small businesses and any niche, but of course, agencies focused on content creation. It's only helped us immensely. It doesn't mean you lose any of the interpersonal dynamics. It just means that there's this supporting system or safety net so that everyone is aware of what we're actually doing here together.
For sure. And good writers actually like it too. Yes. What it does is it removes their blockers.
Yes.
So this happened all the time when I was freelancing, as a client would be like, oh, we're not going to keep working with you. Like after, you know, initial conversation. And I'm like, okay, well, why? And they're like, oh, well, you know, like you wrote it like this and we like this style.
Exactly.
And I'm like, okay, well, just tell me that then. Like, yes. I would have changed it. I would have done it differently if you just told me that up front and didn't like wait till I wasted my time doing it in a different direction.
Well, yes, it put the onus on the freelancer, I remember it well, to always state clearly in the intro messages without being too pushy, please deliver very explicit feedback on these initial pieces because I don't want to get cut next week because you didn't like
it. Yeah, exactly. It needs to be concrete feedback. So it needs to say not like, this doesn't sound right. It needs to be like, this subheader should be written like a headline where there's some action, or like it needs to be very crystal clear. And the hardest thing for a writer is to like sit down to a blank page and like come up with words. That's like the most difficult, challenging, you know, soul sucking part of it. But if you tell them like, here's like the little template to use for the intro, here's how the subhead should be written, here's how the body should be written and put together, it makes a writer's life easy, because then you just sit down and you can just go like write super fast, you know, like you're removing all the blockers that makes their life difficult and making their life simpler. And so they like structure. The hard part and the ingenuity comes in the phrasing, the writing, the like the actual storytelling. They can focus on that. They don't have to focus on like all the, you know, simple, straightforward stuff that just is spelled out for them.
Yeah. I love it, Brad. I really appreciate all the tips today. It's, you know, there's obviously we could go ad infinitum or for some ad nauseum about like how to structure this, right? Like each of these parts of your process. But for people thinking of scaling a writer team, I think a lot of tips you shared today are extremely helpful. I know I learned a couple things. Manage the buffer. I'm going to remember to walk away with this one from. So it'll be time stamped. Thanks so much for agreeing to sit down and share what you know. I really appreciate it.
Of course, I'm happy to do it. Like I said, this is like all the stuff, all the stuff that's hard that no one talks about. And I'm hope that it's been helpful. So thanks for having me.
Yeah, and tell us how is. I looked at it briefly. I can only imagine if we were still a content team, how is Wordable going to fit in here and just streamline this distribution? Not we're saying PR wise, but to the end user.
Yeah, exactly. So we internally, so we have like, I don't know, like a dozen or two clients. Each client has like their own content management system they work on, their own specifications.
Oh gosh, I remember
in terms
those
of like
points so well.
Like, yeah, images should be this way. We write all attributes this way. And so we do all the content and optimization for these clients, and we do it all manually. So we literally spend thousands of dollars internally on labor. And it's really difficult at high volume. So we do, when we work with clients on a large scale, like let's say we'll have like a Friday delivery to clients. So we'll get like 20 articles approved at one time. And all the collaboration often happens in Google Docs or somewhere like that, because it's easier for, and this is how most writing teams operate, I know. But the challenge then is like, okay, so how do you go from like approved in Google Docs to like actually done, like out the door? Because you spent money on all this content.
Well, it's easy, Brad. You spend about 7 hours wrangling something in WordPress and then publish it and then realize 17 things are still unaddressed.
Yes.
And
yes.
The CROs and like images are missing.
And yep. And like you copied and pasted some things, so you get all these random span tags now in WordPress and it's screwed.
Oh, I feel like I can reignite some old shuttered projects that seriously, that was, I'd never want to do any CMS again in my life.
Now multiply that across like WordPress, Contentful, Webflow, Shopify, like HubSpot. Like, so we had always been, I've been a customer for Wordable probably since near the beginning, since when like Benji and Devesh first created it.
It was by Benji and Devesh. Really?
Yeah, they created it in 2016. They may have sold it within like a year. I can't remember exactly how long they held on to it, but I was always like, oh, it's such a great idea. The problems were that it only worked with WordPress at the time, and it only works with Google Docs. And there were still so many other things that from a practical side, we still need to do to the content before getting it, optimizing it and everything else. So it was up for sale a year ago or so. And the more we looked at it, the more we thought it makes a lot of sense. It's always been like a really good version one product in my mind. Our thought for how to evolve it would be, it'd be a million times more useful if we could do things in bulk. So if we could grab 20 docs at a time and export them immediately, like that would be amazing. It would
be
amazing.
I think people need to go to your website and just try the three. I mean, it's so easy to do a trial the way you set it up. I think they need to try that. I'll definitely have a link here in the description. I mean, It's a super cool concept. I don't know if we did 300 a month when we were a content agency, but it was definitely in the 100 plus, even for smaller teams, even for dozens.
It's another one of those things that just makes no sense to spend on average 30 minutes to an hour is what we see per article. Well,
it's literally a position at any content team is the content uploader.
Yep, exactly. So thank you. So bulk imports. Also, you can upload, if you write in like a different different program other than Google Docs, you can import a zip file. So we're adding like input sources. We have transformations. So for example, if you're publishing to a WordPress site, you could select the author, you can select the category, you can open links in a new tab, you can compress images, you can, we're adding all these things in and automating it. Opening links in a new tab, that was always a favorite when you had to like manually click and paste target blank into every single external link.
Let's not talk to you. You're going to bring back nightmares tonight for me. So just
all the, careful. and then on the outside or on like, export sources. We currently have WordPress, HubSpot, Medium, and then we're going to add every CMS basically. So that way for agencies, it's perfect because you're able to publish. We have clients, like big clients that people would know, who have multilingual sites. So they have WordPress setups maybe, but it's like WordPress English, and then they republish that to like whatever, Spanish, French. And so they use Wordable for that too, where it's like an in-house team. They have different collaborators, so it makes it easy because you're kind of centralizing, like the collaborators can push you stuff in Google Docs, and then one person's able to just like manage all of it the same way and push it live. And so that's the goal, is like to really make it a more fully fledged like content management kind of product and help automate a lot of like the soul sucking stuff that usually prevents people from publishing more stuff faster.
Super cool. I think we should wrap it up because I like to keep it short and sweet. I really like it. If you've got a freelance writer, it's just like, it's just plug and play right there into that. I really appreciate it, Brad. Thanks for your time today.
Thank you, Greg. Appreciate it. Always fun catching up.